This evening on the Rock Newman Show, honoring a legend, the life and times of Jim Vance. Today we celebrate the local news anchor extraordinaire who passed away in late July 2017. Here to help us pay tribute are Jim's wife Kathy, co-workers Joe Schriber and Doreen Gentzler, plus fellow news host Bruce Johnson. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. To help us prepare to honor news host, local legend, and my friend, Jim Vance, I'd like to start off with some words from the man himself. Here is Jim Vance during a visit right here on the Rock Newman Show. Something that we don't want to happen for a long, long time.
What's that?
But what do you want on your tombstone?
You know what? That's easy. You can ask. She'll take. I told her years ago. I want on my tombstone a few words. Five words. It was a hell of a party. That's what I want on my tombstone. Because that sums it all up for me. I have so thoroughly enjoyed this life, every single day of it. When you wake up in the morning, Rock Newman, don't you wake up with a sense of anticipation about the day ahead of you? That's what I do every morning too. And I'm looking ahead to many, many more days of waking up with a smile on my face so that when I am gone from here and they put that up there, it will speak the truth. It's been one hell of a party. And I'm glad that you were at the party with me, my brother.
I'd like to welcome everyone to the Rock Newman Show. Thank you so much for joining us here today. You know, part of what we heard right there was that infectious belly laugh. And, you know, I start my broadcast off by saying we hope to inspire you stories of extraordinary achievement. And I want to take a moment here to talk to my viewers for a second, because that particular infectious belly laugh that you heard right there is one of the things that Jim Vance liked to do. He liked to have fun. That was indeed infectious. So to my viewers, if you have never seen the piece where Jim Vance and George Michael went back to their most 10-year-old selves and laughed at the model on the on the runway, I want my viewers to do that. Joe Schriber, I'm gonna go to you first because you were George Michael's producer. Were you there that day?
I was. And I was actually in the control room.
Right.
Because you're in there getting ready for the segment that's coming up.
Sure.
And that was like a moment that's frozen in time because it was real.
Yeah.
It was real. And I watched it again last night because I knew I was coming in today.
Right.
And I figured it might come up. And I laughed again as if it was the first time I saw it.
Right. And part of what you saw in the rascal of Jim Vance at that particular clip was he said, hold on, wait a minute. It's coming again. So he sort of instigated it going a second and third time.
Well, you know, Jim and actually Jim did this better than George. Jim could laugh at himself.
Yeah.
It was okay for him to laugh at others.
Yeah.
Because no one took it personally.
Yeah. Kathy, his wife of 30 years.
Yes.
I can only imagine you had a lot of those moments.
We did. We had so much fun. traveling with the kids, and we worked together for most of that 30 years, mm-hmm. and so we had moments at work too that were hilarious.
And I mean, that's something that is beyond. You know, I love my wife. I really, really love my wife. But I don't know if we could work together for
it had its moments.
20 some years. How you do that?
It had its challenges. It did. But we met at the station. We mm-hmm. met, and we were colleagues, and we were friends, and so we had developed a work rhythm. Mm-hmm. And so we could turn on work mm-hmm. and turn off personal life mm-hmm. at any given moment. Mm-hmm. And then as soon as work was done, okay, it's on. But
I don't know if anybody on camera has asked you this before, but knowing Jim Vance, I know him, and sort of as the public knows him, I want to ask a question that I'm sure the public wants to know.
Oh,
so don't hold,
Lord.
So don't
okay.
hold me responsible.
All right, okay.
How did he propose?
Well, he took me to dinner, and he just said, will you marry me? I mean, your classic,
from sometime a very non-traditional guy, it was very traditional.
It was very traditional, and that was that. He didn't get on a knee, but that's okay. Uh-huh. And that was that. It was just a basic proposal, and I said yes.
Doreen, thank you for being here today.
My pleasure. Thank you for doing a program looking back on the life of Jim Vance.
You're more than welcome. You worked with him for how many years?
28.
For 28 years, and was all that time as co-anchor?
Yes. I'm doing today this job I was hired to do 28 years ago. Same partner all that time. I feel really, really, that's a rare event in television news.
Can you talk to us about the initial days, like first getting to know Vance, you know, what the process was? Was he a part of the decision-making process, or was that from just management, or?
I think, I had worked in the NBC family at another station, so I was known to the company, before I was hired, I met Vance. There was a dinner, that he and I often recalled how long ago that seemed and how yeah. far we had come. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure, of course, I think he was involved in that decision. So I came in. I'm 31 years old, yeah. and I'm joining a very established team of three guys who'd been working together for about 10 years before I got there. Vance and George Michael and Bob Ryan, and I think I was not. Maybe I was too young to really be as intimidated as I might have been, because that was. Uh-huh. But I grew up with brothers, yeah. Younger brothers, mm-hmm. and so they gave me a chance. They welcomed me in, mm-hmm. but I feel like they kind of made me prove myself. They weren't immediately.
They were testing me a little bit. I think it's very interesting. You know, sort of, and since we're celebrating, paying tribute to Vance, huh? is during those times, tell us about some of the interaction. Tell us about what you remember most about those times.
I have a really vivid memory of the broadcast when I felt like they said, okay, you're in. Vance and George had a tendency to get a little carried away.
Yeah.
As you see it on full display in that YouTube clip with the model.
Absolutely.
They could get a little carried away, yeah. going off on a tangent mm. about, you know, mm. paying alimony or mm-hmm. Stuff. And I was pretty new and pretty green, and they started off, and I said, you know, I interrupted them and said, you know, something like, weren't we supposed to be talking about the sports, George? Uh-huh. And after that broadcast, they both looked at me like, You know,
she's
okay,
one of the guys.
You got the guts to interrupt us. So it was kind of like that. But I think that there was among all the members of that team mutual respect for smart people who understood their jobs and but also confident enough to be able to take a joke and take a lot of ribbing from their colleagues. And I think that's
having worked with Joe Schriber through the years, interactions with George Michael, talking to Vance, and even on the show that we did with him, part of what came through, and now I think I'm hearing you say it also, was a very high level of respect for each one's commitment to be the best they could be. And it's no accident that you guys were the leading show for a long time.
I think there was a lot of respect, and I think everybody did their job in different ways, but everybody was very committed to getting it right.
Yeah. Bruce, your first meeting and your reflections on the on the early, on the beginnings of your relationship with Vance.
Again, thanks for doing the show. I just think it's great. And about that clip that everybody laughs at, it wasn't the first time she tripped that got everybody laughing, okay? Because if you looked at that clip, Jim is very straight.
Yes.
You know, he's having one of those, you know, it's my job, let me.
Sure.
It's the second and third time she tripped. I mean, and that is so typical of Jim Vance.
Mm-hmm.
That's where it really became an incredible, you know, piece of video.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, you guys talking about it, I'm sitting here laughing all over you because I can envision, you know, that piece. I can't tell you the first time I met Jim Vance because I met Jim Vance 20 different times, and, and each time they became different relationships. But I came to Washington back in 1976.
Right.
I had come from a station in Cincinnati, Ohio, that was a very good number one station, but I was the only black person there.
Yeah.
I mean, no black writers, no other black reporters,
yeah.
no black nothing, just me. And then I come here, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven, because not only did the Channel 9 that I was coming to work for have Max Robinson, Jason Hayward, Maureen Bunyan, we can go on and on and on.
Yeah.
I look over Channel 4, it's got Jim Vance, you know, Channel 7's got Paul Berry, and they're all better than me. You know, all these black people, and they're very good, like they've been here, you know, and I call them the first wave of incredible talent, which said, getting back to what you were going through when you first came to Channel 4, I mean, they look at you and they're sizing you up, and what they want to know is, can you play?
Do you have the chops?
You know, can you contribute? You know, do you belong here?
Yeah.
And so for a while, they're going to watch you.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to help you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how I met Jim Vance, I think it helped that we were both members of Kappa Alpha Psi, greatest fraternity on the face of the earth.
If you have to say so yourself.
Yeah, absolutely right.
might have some challenge to that on the campus of Howard University, but that's okay. You got the floor right now.
Well, you got a great Kappa chapter up here, Zeta. I mean, you know, but so that helped. That's always an entree, you know.
Sure.
And I think it helped that we didn't work at the same station.
Mm-hmm.
I think it helped that we weren't really in competition. He's Jim Vance, the man.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a reporter, you know, just trying to do the best job I can under covering the city. And so had a lot of success. So he watches me, I'm watching him. And so you can play, you know, so that's your entree. You know, if I'd been a screw up, I probably never would have met Jim Vance, or it would have been a short conversation.
Mm-hmm.
But the first few times I can recall, it's kind of like, here I am, what can I do to help you?
Yeah.
And I'm like, whoa, you know, and you know, I'm one of those guys, broken family, and I don't trust anybody, you know, especially somebody, what can I do to help you? And
yeah, trying to set you up.
And Doreen and I, when we were talking, you know, after he passed, you know, one time we were all having breakfast, me, Jim, Cortland Malloy, and some other guys, just kicking and talking, you know, just trying to be a support group for one another. Because the job, while we're privileged, we're lucky, it also can be tough, you know, if only in your head, you know, that sort of thing. And we were all smokers back then. I mean, I learned how to smoke in this business, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Smoking, drinking, you learn from journalists. That's what you're supposed to do, you know what I mean? And but Jim says at this one meeting, breakfast meeting, I think it was Columbia Station, Adams Morgan, I'm gonna stop smoking. I'm going to a hypnotist. Well, that was it.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to the hypnotist. Cortland's going to the hypnotist.
Uh-huh.
And the same one.
Yeah.
I went to the hypnotist, stopped smoking.
Mm-hmm.
Cortland goes to the hypnotist, stops smoking.
Huh.
Jim couldn't stop,
you
know. But I say all that to say he offered that to us.
Sure.
Okay. He hadn't thought about it, you know, and Doreen, I'll never forget when we were talking again, and she's like, I bet that made him mad when you guys quit and he wasn't able to quit, you know. Yeah. That is too a part of the gym, you know. So I don't know what he did after that.
Sure.
To stop smoking, but that's the kind of guy he was.
Yeah.
And you guys know Jim's the kind of guy that we'll talk again on Monday, okay?
Yeah.
Why don't we make this work a thing? Every Monday we'll talk. Okay. Uh-huh. So Monday comes, no Jim.
Uh-huh.
The next Monday.
Right.
The next month, you don't hear. And then finally when you meet, hey, my man.
Yeah,
hey,
that's,
you
right. Know, that's right.
You know, it's like you never stop, you know, communicating.
A Marion Barry quality.
Absolutely right. And then it becomes the next, you know, relationship. And then the next, and you just build on it. I mean, I love the guy. I mean, we were.
Kathy, I'm going to ask you if he ever shared with you, Reverend Willie Wilson from Union Temple Baptist Church, did the private ceremony, officiated the private ceremony. So so we talked just prior to that, and he talked about how Jim talked to him, and he asked him, where did your style come from? And he gave an answer that he would sit around the table with his family, with his aunts and uncles, and how they would sort of deliver the day's news, sort of barbershop style. And that's very much what stayed a part of him, became a part of him. You ever have any insight into that?
Oh, well, that's exactly what happened. And they're still doing it now. the next generation of Vance's. Vance's family in Philly, you know, they were bootstraps people.
Mm-hmm.
And they succeeded, every one of them, at determination and grit, and they reached a level of education and sophistication and knowledge that anybody would want to achieve.
Yeah.
And that was the example for Vance. Mm-hmm. He saw people working hard to get what they wanted and needed, and to give back as well.
Yeah.
And so, Vance learned everything about the news and learned to be hungry for the news, and he's instilled that in our kids too.
Yeah, he gave a reflection when on the show about his granddad, man, and what his granddad, he took the risk of giving up a job because he was being mistreated in the time of depression, and started his own business and went out and painted the van that had Vance and Sons. And what a proud moment that was. You could tell how that resonated with him to the day when we did this just a year or so ago.
Yeah. No, Vance was, you know, the thing about Vance, there was a quote when the station celebrated Vance's 25th anniversary, they wanted to give him some kind of an award. And so they asked me, what kind of quote could we put on here? Yeah. And so, of course, he couldn't know. And so I was just probing him and, you know, what if you were going to have, you know, those kind of questions.
Yeah.
The quote he came up with was a quote from his grandfather that said, "All honest work is noble."
Uh-huh.
And that was Vance's motto.
Yeah.
You know, you work hard.
Yeah.
You do what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
That's a noble man. And Vance was a noble man because he gave everything to his job and to anything that he did.
Yeah.
He gave it his all.
You know what? We have a clip of which he spoke of getting some inspiration, and he quoted one of the giants from the industry, David Brinkley. Let's take a look.
If I'm going to mention anybody of having an influence, it would be David Brinkley, who was one of the most decent men I've ever known in my life. And I will never forget, I went to the cafeteria one day as soon as I started, and he was in there in the morning. And I said, "You got a minute?" He said, "Yeah." We sat down, and I said, "I need some advice from you. You got to tell me, every single time the camera goes on, I'm terrified. I want to pee. I'm so scared."
Right.
David is sitting there. I remember he was eating an omelet. And David said, "Well, Jim, I'll tell you the truth." You know, he talked that funny
absolutely.
Way.
Absolutely.
"The day comes, the light goes on, and you don't get nervous. Get the hell out of the business."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Him and the jelly.
Yeah.
And I'm like, is that it? You know, and that was it. But anyway, watching him taking note of his commitment to task, And his enthusiasm about it after all of those years that he had already been in the business was inspirational.
Doreen, I want to come to you on something and ask you if you can remember being in the moment. Jim did something that one could think to be political suicide in this market. Mm-hmm. Think of them as you will. The Washington football team, they're probably not more rabid fans anywhere in the world that live up and embrace their team as this fan base does. This is the fan base to which you all, as broadcasters, communicate with. And Jim went out without any apology and very strongly said, the name of the football team, the Redskins, sucks. That was extraordinarily courageous. It's not something that any way he was required to do, he had to do, and he had to know that he was going to take some heat by that. Do you remember him doing that and how you felt, what you thought when he did it?
He was an early adapter of that. I think more people have made that decision since, but he was one of the first people, at least in D.C., to make that decision. He felt it was the right thing to do, right. And he felt very strongly about it. And
What I'm asking is, do you remember how you felt about him doing it, what it meant for the broadcast? How did the folks at the station feel?
Well,
because
I think it's a gutsy move. Yeah, it was a gutsy move, and I think he took some heat from the bosses. We carry Redskins preseason games. Mm-hmm. You know, that's an important relationship, mm-hmm. and I think he took some heat from the managers. I remember thinking that's a gutsy move,
yeah.
And good for you. And it became a little bit of a game because it would still appear in the copy all the time,
uh-huh.
And it became entertaining for me to watch him try to get around it.
Yeah.
You know, every once in a while one would just almost slip through or would slip through.
Mm-hmm.
I watched producers begin to start to change writing copy for him, and yeah. That took some of the fun out of it for me.
Uh-huh.
Just watching him, but he felt it strongly,
yeah.
and I support that.
Yeah.
I didn't feel it was my job to refuse to say something. Mm-hmm. You know, people. Mm-hmm.
But he did.
He did, and he
was willing to take the heat. And of course,
yes.
You know, that's part definition of character.
Rock,
yes.
Rock, it's huge. It's
yes.
huge because we can talk about how great Jim was or a great guy he was. You know, but it's also lonely at the top.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, nobody had that position but Jim Vance.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So. You know, you see others do it,
yeah.
You know, and just to be quite direct, I mean, you might see a white anchor do it.
Right.
Okay, you expect that white male anchor, he can say that, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But to have a black anchor or a female anchor to come mm-hmm. out and say something like that, to take on
mm-hmm.
the Washington, you know, burgundy and gold,
sure.
and that is huge.
Yeah.
And I think that resonates with people. The question I'm asking is, what point in time, well, I think I know the answer, but at what point in time did Jim feel that he could do that?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
And there might have been another time, you know, before then when he couldn't do that or mm-hmm. didn't feel he could do
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
And that therein comes that confidence thing. I go back to that, you know, conversation with David Brinkley. That's important stuff. He's
yeah.
going to this guy and he knows this guy can do and say all these other things
yeah.
because it's just accepted.
Right.
Where's my box? Where's my platform? What can
yeah.
I say? The thing I used to spend a lot of time talking to Jim about were the things that he couldn't say.
Uh-huh.
because you gotta say it somewhere. You gotta bounce this stuff off of people. Because we've all wanted to scream about things that are going on that we cover, that we read about. Mm-hmm. But it's not our job. We're in this box. When can you get out of the box? Uh-huh. When can you give yourself permission? And will your boss stand behind you? Yeah. They all say they'll stand behind you until they start seeing how the viewers respond and the public responds.
Yeah. Or the advertisers.
More importantly,
it was obviously on the tube every 5 days a week. You saw the relationship, again, I'm going back to George Michael. We've got Joe Schriber here, George Michael's producer. You saw their chemistry. Mm-hmm. What many people didn't have an opportunity to see or to know about. I called Joe Schriber before we were doing the broadcast with Vance and talked to him about some of his memories, some of his reflections. And one of the things, Joe, you talked about was the moment when Jim spoke at George's funeral.
It was the most moving eulogy. No slight to Coach Joe Gibbs, who was there, who honored George, but it came from the heart and the soul. It was so real, and it opened up a door into what their relationship was. And I don't want to get too far off the path, but you know, that connection goes way back to Philadelphia.
Okay.
George got to Philly when Vance was just getting out of college.
Okay.
George was a big rock and roll DJ at that time. Mm-hmm. And he's playing the Spinners, all in Philadelphia Soul, the Spinners, Lou Rawls, all those guys.
Yeah.
And he's forming that connection and bond of that audience in that city. He didn't discriminate between soul music or rock and roll. And he's becoming a star.
Yeah.
You know, interviews with the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and so forth.
Yeah.
So Vance leaves. He comes to D.C. George goes to New York. And then they get together in Washington.
Yeah.
And George needed to be on stage with a star.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And because he grew up in show business, Berry Gordy was the guy who molded him as a record promoter when George was doing that. Mm-hmm. So now he's got Vance.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of the connection they have going back to those Philadelphia days.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a different era back then. You guys all know this. This is no slight to television now, but
sure.
That was a day and age where appointment viewing, millions of viewers in front of watching just a few people on TV, millions of advertising dollars at stake. You had to be really special to be on TV.
Yeah.
Nowadays, there are so many channels and so many web shows. You had to command that presence. And if George didn't have somebody next to him who was up to that, he suffered. He suffered. Yeah. The four of you together for so long, you know, referring to Arch and Bob back then, you know, that was magical and hard to touch. And, you know, going back to your question, there was a respect for working really hard, understanding the show business that was at hand, and a dedication and putting your feet in the shoes of the audience.
Kathy. We're talking, part of what we've been talking about here is like sort of the professional Jim Vance, Jim Vance and where that came from. Being the rock star that he was, being the hard worker that he was, there were obvious, well-known, publicized frailties, again, which he talked about on the show. And I think what came across when we were doing our interview, that it was important for the folks that were going to be watching him there to understand his realness, and that far from hiding his frailties, he wanted to put them on full display. Let's take a look here, and I want to come back to that.
It's actually kind of Dickensian, in that they were, in fact, the worst of times, but maybe the best of times subsequent to that. Let me try to explain. 79 to 87 is when the worst times was. I experienced a level of depravity, the likes of which I didn't know was possible. And I experienced a moral degradation that I could not and never have believed was part of my life. It was all because of cocaine. Mm-hmm. When I talk about the upside of it is what I learned from that experience. And what I learned was so very, very much. The part that lingers the most is the effect of what my addiction had on the people closest to me, yeah. to Kathy,
yeah.
To my kids, mm-hmm. To my coworkers who knew something was going on and watching me fall, and they couldn't do anything about it.
So you went through some very, very dark days. It's chronicled. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that. what I would like to do is if you could share with us the time that you felt he's gotten over this hump.
It was shortly before we got married, mm-hmm. because there were a lot of humps yeah. that he got over, and then he went back, and he got over, and mm-hmm. he went back. Mm-hmm. And the dark days, that's probably an understatement mm-hmm. for him, for all of us. Mm-hmm. But what is interesting in watching that clip actually touched me. You know, one of the things about an addict, there's deception, there's yeah. manipulation, sure. there's lying, sure. there's all yeah. that kind of stuff.
On a grand scale.
On a grand scale. Yeah. And it was when Vance started telling the truth mm-hmm. that I knew he was over the hump. When he started talking boldly about, this is what I did.
Yeah.
This is how I'm managing it.
Yeah.
This is how I hope to continue to manage it for the rest of my life.
You saw him taking off the mask.
I saw him take the mask off. And that was when I knew he was going to be okay. And he was okay.
Yeah.
He was okay.
Bruce,
after that.
You were a cut buddy. you were a cut buddy, man. And so tell us about some of those times.
You know, I'm listening to Kathy, I'm reminded of what comedian Chris Rock said. When you meet me, you don't meet me, you meet my representative, the yeah. person I want you to think I am.
Yeah, sure.
Okay?
Sure.
And that's what Jim and I would talk about, you mm-hmm. know, the real person versus the representative.
Mm-hmm. Talking about yourselves?
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, mm-hmm. Because you don't know who you are.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to assume, I was never into drugs, but I'm going to assume the drugs allowed him to be early on, the person he thought he wanted to be, the person uh-huh. you expected him to be,
yeah.
okay?
Yeah.
Now, and depending on what group you're in, that's yeah. the person he is. So yeah. he loses himself in all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So in one of our many, many conversations over the years, we would talk about discovering who we are and why we're here. And yeah. it starts with, I mean, I don't want to get spiritual on you, but
it's
but
okay.
we conclude, yeah. conclude it starts with grace.
Mm-hmm.
This is who you are.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of what you do is grace.
Yeah.
I mean, this is what you were sent here to do. Mm-hmm. You don't try to explain it. You don't mm-hmm. try to fight it. You
yeah.
certainly don't become egotistical over it. Mm-hmm. You accept it.
Mm-hmm.
He said to me after some years, and I don't even remember saying it, but he said I said it, so I'll take the credit for it. He says, I gave him a great piece of advice one time, and that is just show up.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
because and what I do know that I would always say to him is, you have no idea the impact you have on the rest of us by just mm-hmm. showing up and being
mm-hmm.
there.
Mm-hmm.
Not every other day, not mm-hmm. once a week, but mm-hmm. every day. Because if you can show up, we can show up.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
We've got permission to show up.
Yeah.
Because we fed off of that. Again, I go back to, you know, he was the man. You
yeah.
know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in his own world, he also had the fear. I remember when Max Robinson was here. Mm-hmm. He's afraid of Max Robinson. Because
mm-hmm.
Max Robinson at one time was the man.
Yeah.
It's tough being the man.
Yeah.
I used to say to Jim, I don't know that I could ever be the man. I don't know if I could handle it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of what you saw you know, in this clip and what Kathy was saying, it's hard handling that because everybody's pulling at you. Not to yeah. make excuses.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay?
Oh, no, I understand.
Not to make excuses, but
yeah.
one time we got in this long conversation about how to say no.
Uh-huh.
Because people always want you to do things.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
The truth of the matter is, a lot of them expect you to say no because they figure yeah. you got other things to do, but you
yeah.
don't know that. In your head, you got to
yeah.
do all this.
Yeah.
You know, and one of the things we agreed is, to never volunteer the other one to do something that you don't want to do.
Yeah.
And that goes on a lot in his business.
Yes,
okay.
Indeed.
And
yes,
I know that just from since he's passed, I made the mistake of saying on the air one time to, you know, one of our frat buddies.
Yeah.
He can't do that. Okay, I'll do that for you. And then, by the time I get up there, three more phone calls.
Yeah.
Stuff Jim had committed to.
Sure.
Can you do this too?
Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah.
You know. So we talk just men.
Yeah.
About men stuff.
Yeah.
And you know. I mean, guys, we don't talk about our women.
Yeah.
You know, our feelings. Uh-huh. You're exposing yourself. And when you expose yourself as a guy, you know, then the question comes back, you gonna hurt me with this? What are you gonna do with this?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And if you can get to the point where you don't worry about that.
Part of us, I actually was having a conversation over the weekend, and I was telling this young lady she's 40 years old, and she's meeting this guy. He's 54 years old, and she was talking about, you know, some of the challenges that they had. And I said, well, you know, one time when I was in Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas, Sinbad was on stage, and he talked to all the women and said, anybody in here got a 10-year-old son? And several people raised their hand. He said, well, that's your husband is always going to be 10 years old. So we have our challenges.
Yeah.
Doreen, you, here's a wife talking about the issue, you know, a friend. Uh-huh. Now, in a sense, you all professionally are a duo. You are a team. Mm-hmm. And your teammate, who's the man, now is failing to show up. What was that like?
So I don't know that Vance. I came in 1989, and he had overcome the issues that we're talking about.
Uh-huh.
I do want to expand a little bit on what you and Bruce are talking about. He did an interview with me a couple of years ago as part of our project at the station, Changing Minds,
yes,
about mental health.
Yes.
And he talked about his struggles with depression, and that was a very gutsy thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't ask him to do it. He volunteered to do it. It's another example of him putting himself out there. He talked about feeling deeply insecure, and also about feeling like he walked around with a backpack full of masks, and he'd you know, take a mask out for each encounter.
Yeah.
I guess what Bruce is talking about presenting a different persona.
Sure.
I was amazed that he put himself out there like that in such a public way.
Mm-hmm.
I also know what a wonderful thing that was that he did.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot tell you, I'll never know how many people he heard from personally.
Yeah.
I know he did. I know I have heard about that interview over and over again from people who say, you know, it meant so much to me to see Jim Vance talking about his struggles are the same things I'm feeling, and he got help. And he's feeling better. The way that project started was we were talking with another pretty prominent African American leader in the community who also struggles with depression, and it was going to be a larger project, and the other person backed out, and Vance said, "Let's do it."
You know, there is such an interesting mix of abject vulnerability and courage. I mean, there was such an interesting mix of that and everything in between. I mentioned something a little bit earlier about his, you know, his infectious smile and laugh. And man, we touched a nerve when we did the show, when I brought up the name Muhammad Ali and what impact Ali had on him. And, you know, Bruce sitting here from Louisville, Kentucky, so we know that history. But we talked some pretty heavy stuff here. I want to transition a little bit and take a look at what I'm talking about here.
I asked him for 30 seconds, just the honest to God truth, I'm going to tell you, he gave me at least 15 minutes. It might have been more. Yeah. Who was counting?
Yeah.
You know
what I mean? Yeah,
yeah. And we, you know, I got the interview out of the way like that. Mm-hmm. And we just started talking then about life and, you know, being a black man in America. Yeah. And that is when he dropped the pearl on me. I have never forgotten it. He said, because I was asking him about, you know, aren't you angry? Don't you want to hurt somebody? Aren't you afraid about, you know, the prime of your life is disappearing? And I'll never forget, Muhammad leaned over and said, here's what an old man told me one time. Man can never know if he's a man until he's tested and tried.
Yeah.
I'm being tested, I'm being tried, but I'm a man.
He's
never forget that.
He's your hero. Without a shadow of a doubt. That, since he's your hero, that means I cannot resist what I'm about to do right now.
What's that?
This is the legend of Cassius Clay, the most beautiful fighter of the world today. He talks a great deal and brags indeed of a muscular punch that's incredibly speedy. The fistic world was dull and weary. With a champ like Liston, things had to be dreary. Then someone with color, someone with dash, brought fight fans a-running with cash. The brash young boxer is something to see, and the heavyweight championship is his destiny. The kid fights great. He's got speed and insurance. He's got speed and endurance. If you sign to fight him, you better raise your insurance. All rumble, young man, rumble. He's my hero, too.
Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee.
Can't hit, but you can't see.
That was wonderful.
Thank you. He says there, you can't know what you're made of, paraphrasing, until you're tested. So he was tested and was, you know, I think about the parallel of Muhammad Ali became greater after Joe Frazier beat him in his comeback fight at Madison Square Garden. He became greater after he stood up against, spoke truth to power in the Vietnam War. And he was crushed. He was crushed. He was deprived of his title. He was knocked down, you know, and he came back. And, you know, sort of as a parallel, Jim came back from the depths. He literally came back from what seemed to have been a bottomless pit.
It was.
And survived it and then thrived and became a much more of a force in the community for greater good for the rest of his days.
That's true. But it wasn't easy.
Mm-hmm.
And this was no Phoenix rising from the ashes.
Mm-hmm.
Vance was humbled.
Yeah.
He had to be humbled.
Mm-hmm.
He had to be humbled in order to get clean.
Yeah.
And look, there were days that Vance caught the bus everywhere he went because he had lost his car.
Yeah.
He caught the bus. He would catch buses to meetings to go day after day to make sure maybe 2-3 times a day to try to stay sober.
Yeah.
And you know, this is this great anchorman who, when I met him, he was driving a Porsche, and now he's catching the bus.
Yeah, this is important for everybody viewing to understand this.
And so, inch by inch, piece by piece, he built himself back up. We all helped, all of the family and the good friends. There were some very bad friends who tried to pull him back, but he knew that that's not where he wanted to be. And from that moment, that he made up his mind. He made up his mind also to bring others along with him so that they could do better too. So that they could.
Bruce, in your meetings at the Deluxe Cafe, your lunches at the Deluxe Cafe.
Dinners. Yeah, Wisconsin Avenue,
Talking about these times here and those humble times.
I'll tell you, as I was listening to Kathy, I'm also reminded, as he was often reminded, would also talk about all the people that didn't give up on him.
Yeah.
Jackie Bradford, this lady sitting here. I mean, he had a support system.
Yeah.
You know, often gave people the excuse they needed to get rid of him, along with the fat paycheck, blah, blah. Now, granted, he made a lot of money, you know, for Channel 4 and NBC and all that, too.
Sure.
So that weighs into it also.
Sure.
But I'm listening to this and I'm like, another example of not giving up on people.
Yeah.
You know, we don't leave people behind.
Which is sometimes easy to do.
Absolutely right. But, you know, again, getting to the point, it becomes, I got the impression from the Jim Vance I knew that it had become easier. Acceptance had set in, you know. The fog had lifted. Mm-hmm. He had a pretty good idea of who he was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he didn't want to die.
Yeah.
Who does?
Yeah.
But it's kind of like it's complete. You know, he's done his bit. Mm-hmm. This is what I was here for. And I think the evidence is how you and this show,
yeah.
and you were talking about my hero, Muhammad Ali.
I mean, I
was there a year ago for his funeral.
Yeah.
People came from all over the world.
Yeah.
So you want to know somebody's impact.
Yeah.
Let's see what they do once he's gone.
Yeah.
If they're like good riddance or if they're trying to hold on or people coming out of the woodwork mm-hmm. with the stories, the impact.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of the people that I'm hearing from are people that never met Jim Vance.
Yeah.
You know, the symbolism, what he meant.
Yeah.
Showing up, just being there.
Yeah.
He never knew a lot of that. He knew a lot of it, but
mm-hmm.
he had no idea how big it was.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it'd probably just get bigger and bigger. And Jim would probably say, you know, in mm-hmm. some of the stories, you know, mm-hmm. some of them would be lies, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Some
mm-hmm.
people will embellish stuff. But mm-hmm. but at the same time, the guy came, he played, he had an incredible impact, not just at Channel 4, not just for Channel 4 viewers,
mm-hmm.
but for the city.
Mm-hmm.
But again, I tell you guys all the time.
Joe Schriber, you still look like a young man, but you were a relatively young man during those days. And so, you know, you produced for George, you were part of his success, therefore, you know, the station's success, but always you're operating where at the end of the day, he's the man. They became a team, he was the man. So, looking at that man from a professional point of view, what was it that you took away from sort of the style, the approach, the energy of a Jim Vance?
Well, first of all, by the way, working for George, there are a lot of days I felt really old when I was young.
Yeah.
Doreen knows
yeah.
that.
Not the easiest person to work with. We can say that.
I remember when Vance passed and, you know, trying to post something profound on Facebook, and the first thing that came to my mind was Jim was the coolest guy in the room but wasn't trying to be.
Yeah.
And that duende, that it, that's hard to find.
Yeah.
But the thing that made it special is that he cared so much about empowering other people. It was genuine.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, you'd watch him
mm-hmm.
and you know, he and George were similar in the sense that, you know, they really were regular guys. And look,
yeah.
they loved the stage. They
yeah.
loved the wealth that it brings.
Yeah.
But, you know, George was much more, Dorinosis, much more comfortable in Wranglers on a horse.
Yeah.
You take George to a country club and he freaked out.
Yeah.
He was
yeah.
miserable.
Yeah.
Vance wanted to be on his Harley
yeah.
amongst regular folk.
Yeah.
And that stood out to me a lot.
Mm-hmm.
That means so much to me. It's rubbed off on me till this day.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is something that you talked about and you elaborated on. When Vance bouncing back, that process of post-traumatic growth and
yeah.
resilience, which is it's a long process,
yeah.
and I'm very familiar with recovery and so forth. That resonated a lot with me,
you
too.
You know what, man? Part of what you just defined there was a star. He's a star.
Yes, no doubt.
Who I don't think has anybody seen of that bright, shining star any pretentiousness?
No.
Like, you know, and I'm just kind of thinking about that right now in terms of what his status was in the community, you know, longest serving anchor, you know, one of the most well-known faces, you know, in the city, in the community, but never any pretentiousness. And I was speaking to Mike Wise, who
uh-huh.
did a wonderful piece, Mike Wise from The Undefeated.
Uh-huh.
And I remembered, again, going back to the show, I said, you know what, he was a man. And then I said, you know, he was so cool. He came to the interview And he had on like a pair of jeans, and he had a shirt and a shirt and a sweater and a leather jacket. Now, and it was just so cool. And he, I'll take your words. He wasn't trying to be cool. He had swag before anybody defined what swag was.
Mm-hmm. He did. But I have a pardon me, country club story to tell you too.
Mm-hmm.
This was, I don't know, not that many years ago, when he was getting a Broadcaster of the Year award, right. and it was being presented at a country club. Mm-hmm. And we arrived there, and there was nobody in the coat check. Vance had on his tuxedo. He was the honoree of the night.
Mm-hmm.
And so he goes behind and puts his coat, hangs up our coats.
Right.
And a gentleman came along and handed Vance his
coat. I knew that was coming.
And Vance took it.
Yes.
Hung it up. And the guy offered him a tip, no thanks.
Uh-huh.
And then Vance walked in and got his award. So he was comfortable at a country club in some aspect of it.
Wouldn't you like to be that guy sitting in the audience watching him go up
right.
to get his award? You know,
that guy probably didn't have any clue. I'd go places with Vance, and we'd go to an event or something, and pull up. The parking attendant be all up, Mr. Vance,
right.
Good to see you. How long are you going to be? Let me put your car right up here in the front. Let me take it. And Vance would spend just as much time. He'd take his time listening to that guy. You spoke at my graduation, and then you spoke at my son's graduation.
Yeah.
And he'd it'd be like that. And he could walk in, and the CEO, the whoever the dignitaries were, he was just as comfortable talking to them. And I'd just kind of travel in his wake.
Mm-hmm. Tell us, we've got about 4 minutes left here. Tell us about what is going to be the tribute to him. The services are public. Memorial. How could you not have a public memorial?
Yeah.
That's going to be at the Washington Cathedral.
At the National Cathedral.
Tell us about when.
Well, it's September 12th.
Okay.
At 10 a.m.
Okay.
But you have to have tickets.
Uh huh.
So, if you haven't signed up for tickets, I heard that there was a waiting list actually, but you would want to go on the Channel 4 website and see if you could. Get a ticket. It's gonna be spectacular.
I can only imagine that is going to be very, very special.
But I believe it's 10 a.m.
Uh-huh.
And I believe it's going to be broadcast as well as live stream.
It will be broadcast on NBC 4,
yeah.
4 and it'll be online NBCWashington.com.
So let me say in these last few moments here, if I could get each of you, starting with you, Kathy. Let's go out on this note. A favorite moment with Jim Vance?
My very favorite moment with Vance was when we went to Vietnam to do a story on the 20th anniversary of the war. And we spent 9 days there, and we went from Hanoi to Ho Chi Minh City.
Yeah.
And we were both tested because America was not welcome there yet.
Yeah, sure.
And it was fabulous. It was just a wonderful time.
This is a crazy story. When my whole run ended, 23 years at NBC,
yeah.
George took us all into a room, and he had to, quote unquote, fire us, give us severance, and send us on our way. And there was a big group of us. He brought Vance in as a witness. And he brought Vance in as a witness. And I remember Jim there, and I had kind of gotten a little heads up of what was going to go down. So I took my bullet at the time, but it was just so comforting that Vance was in there. And it was the best thing that ever happened to me. But having him there at that time, for the next stage of my life, I'll never forget it.
Wow. We got 2 minutes left. We got two of you.
Election night, 2008.
Ah, did he cry?
No, neither one of us cried, but just to me, to be sitting next to him, and I'll set the scene just a little bit.
Sure.
We're waiting for the numbers to come in, And we're hearing in our ear, there's some commotion going on over on 14th Street.
Yeah.
And the control room is sort of chaotic, trying to decide what they're going to do. And we're hearing that the Obamas are about to walk out on the stage in Chicago.
Yeah.
And then we're hearing, well, you know, there's a party breaking out on 14th Street.
Yeah.
And just to be sitting next to Vance,
yeah, euphoria.
And experiencing that kind of through his eyes, something that he never thought he would see, and I never thought I would see it.
Sure.
Just to be sitting there with him for that.
Bruce, we got 1 minute left.
A text message. He's dying, and I'm texting him. I haven't heard from you, And so I get a text back. You know, yo, bruh, great hearing from him. How you doing? Asking me how I'm doing.
Yeah.
That and the last time I saw him, mm-hmm. was at his house, Silver Spring.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna talk about dying. We talk about living. We talk about what he was gonna do. This is gonna be his last year at Channel 4. What he wants to do. And I was gonna be going to Cuba.
Mm-hmm.
And he said I want to go to Cuba.
Yeah. Man, we got 30 seconds, and so I'll say that I asked him about whether or not he thought I'd have Dennis Rodman on. And he said, you know, you do a very valuable service. And you got a great purpose, and your time is finite, and you ought to use that time in the most valuable way that you can. I don't think Rodman fits that. He really cared. He gave me a suggestion that he really cared about. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Thank you and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.